This audio is brought to you by Muslim Central. Please consider donating to help cover our running costs and future projects by visiting www.muslimcentral.com/donate.
Muslims, we are people of vision. Muslims, we are people who aspire greatness. This is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you and me. My brothers, look at the positive light to understand who we are and why we are created. Do not be like those who have forgotten Allah, so Allah has caused them to forget themselves.
As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters in Islam, one of the greatest surahs of the Qur'an is a surah known as Surah Yusuf. It's one of the most amazing surahs, would you agree? It is, mashallah. And what was Surah Yusuf all about? It was about this young boy who has such tremendous potential, exquisite beauty, absolutely amazing, amazing piety, but then he had an almost hopeless future because he was just about to be thrown into the well by his brothers, to be doomed, to be drowned by water in the depths of something where his father would never ever find him. And so subhanahu khaliqul azim, everyone forgot about him, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was always there for him. Then he was saved, but only to be sold off as a slave. Then thereafter, what happened to him after that? What happened to him was amazing. A woman wanted to take advantage of him and his beauty and his handsomeness. And unfortunately, because of that, he stuck to his values and principles and he entered into this Jahannam, this hellfire of this world, which is prison. And the prisons of that time are not the prisons of now, with nice beds and nice food and doctors to look after you. They were dungeons. Dungeons, the ones that you've seen in various movies. Really, really bad places to live. And he stayed there for how long? Years and years and years. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled his victory. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled his word. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled the promise that he had made to all people who are righteous. To all people who hold on to his faith. To all of those who are unwavering in the support of his deen. To all of those who bite onto his religion with his and her molar tooth. And what is it? It is this verse in Surah Yusuf which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that shows it. وَاللَّهُ غَالِبٌ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. And Allah of a surety will establish his affair, even if the vast majority of people don't know that. Even if the vast majority of people don't know that. And this is the message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed through Surah Yusuf. When was Surah Yusuf revealed? It was revealed in the year called Aam al-Huzn. Does anyone know about Aam al-Huzn? It was a year of despair. It was a year where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in despair, wasn't he? Why? Because he lost two of his favorite people. Who are they? He lost his favorite, his wife, Khadija radiallahu anha, and he lost his uncle, the one who was providing for him, the one who was supporting him, the one who was defending him from the onslaught of the disbelievers of Quraysh. Abu Talib, right? And so it was a year of despair. So Allah revealed the surah of hope in that year. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to show Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that after all of this difficulty, a person who will still hold on to this deen, Allah of a surety will establish his affair, even if the vast majority of people do not know or do not understand. And by Allah, we have history to show that. If there is any proof that a person requires who doesn't believe in Allah and who doesn't believe in the Quran or the Sunnah, then let history be enough of a proof to show that anyone who holds on to Islam will of a surety ultimately win. Let me tell you the examples of the time of crusaders. The time where a million crusaders, worshippers of the cross, a million of them, they entered into Bayt al-Maqdis. And what did they do? Ibn Kathir says, they did with Bayt al-Maqdis what animals do not do to the forest. And they killed 60,000 people in 1 week. And they ransacked places of worship. And they destroyed them. And they raped hundreds and hundreds and thousands of women. And they killed children. And they cut open babies. And they killed the innocent and the weak. They destroyed every single thing. for 91 years until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised a hero from the heroes of Islam, a giant from the giants of Islam, who said, Ya Islamah, Wa Islamah, who cried out from the mountains of Islam, saying, Woe to Islam! And with that cry, stood up the knights of Islam, 1,000 of them, 100,000 of them, and they struggled and fought until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a victory that is lasting until now. Wallahu ghalibun ala amrihi, walakinna akthara an-nasi la ya'lamun. And then in the year 656 after Hijrah, when Ibn al-Alqami, the treacherous person, minister of the Khalifa at that time in Baghdad, when he opened the gates in the middle of the nights so that the Tatars could come in, what happened at that time? 1 million Muslims were killed. Ibn Kathir says rather 1.3 million Muslims were killed in how long? 1 month. In 1 month, 1.3 million Muslims were killed. And what did they do? They would cut off the heads and they would cut off the bodies and they would put it all around the places of worship. Until when even the Muslims struggled against them, when the Muslims struggled to take over Baghdad from the Tatars and Mongols, they couldn't because of the stench. They said, we had to wait outside the camps of Baghdad, waiting to go into it for 3 months, waiting for the vultures to have eaten the flesh and for the stench to have gone. Because 1.3 million people don't decompose that easily. It takes a huge amount of time for the river of Euphrates to have washed out all that dirt and to have washed out all that filth and to have washed out all the blood of and the guts and the bodies of such innocent human beings. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised a hero. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like He did before, He raised Saifuddin Quds, who fought in the battle of Ain Jalut, the Eye of Goliath, and conquered and took over the Mongols until they were absolutely destroyed. And as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, had it not been for the Muslims, then there would be nothing stopping the rest of the world from the onslaught of the Mongols. Nothing would have been there, because remember at that time, we're talking about the Dark Ages. We're talking about Europe being in Dark Ages, where there was no one around, when there was no one around except Vandals. And subhana khaliqul azim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again the same verse, wallahu ghalibun ala amrihi walakinna akthara an-nasi la ya'lamun. And in the year 280, a group and sect called the Qaramita, who were known as the worst sect that Islam has ever seen, the sect known as the Qaramita, they destroyed Islam in a way you can never imagine. They said that in the year 280, the Abbasid Khalifa sent 10,000 Muslim knights to struggle against this Shia sect called the Qaramita. And the Qaramita circled them, they killed them, they killed all the 10,000 Muslim knights and they burnt their bodies. This Qaramita was such a devilish sect that they hid themselves as Hujjaj. Then they went into Mecca. They killed all the Hujjaj. Listen to this, they killed all the Hujjaj. They threw their bodies into the Zamzam well. They destroyed the Zamzam well. They tore open the Kaaba. They destroyed the Kaaba. They took the black stone. Listen to this. They took the black stone until the black stone was missing from the Kaaba for how long? 22 years. 22 years. The black stone was missing from the Kaaba. That's right. It isn't there right now. I mean, you know, people say, oh, the black stone has got a bit of a depression because of the kissing of the people on the stone. What? That's not true. It's got the depression because the Qaramita were trying to break it open. Because they thought there were diamonds inside it. Ridiculous fools. Anyway, this is what happened. For 22 years it was lost. And then for 8 years, no Hajj. Did you know that? For 8 years there was no Hajj at all because people were so afraid of doing Hajj because of the fitna of these people. But have you heard of the Qaramita before me speaking about it? You probably haven't. One of them is saying you have. Well, alhamdulillah, perhaps you've read history. But the vast majority of you haven't. Why? Because Wallahu ghalibun ala amrihi walakinna akthara an-nasi la ya'lamun. And Allah will of a surety bring His affair to pass, even if the vast majority of people never understand how. And indeed, in this time of difficulty, Allah will of a surety give victory to us. of a surety in this time of difficulty and disgrace for Islam and Muslims. Allah will of a surety give us victory and success. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not give this victory and success unless we follow a particular way and a particular path towards the success. My friends, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so that he could be cursed at. Allah did not send Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so that they could make pictures of him, so that they could mock about him being a pedophile, and so that they could talk about how he was a womanizer. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so that he could be the messenger for all of mankind for all times. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. He is the one who sent this man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the one who sent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam بِالْهُدَى, with the guidance and the right religion, in order to make it paramount over all things, over all ideologies, even if the disbelievers dislike it. Allah also says, وَكَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَأَغْلِبَنَّ أَنَا وَرُسُولِي. Allah says, and Allah has written, verily I and my Rusul and my messengers will be the ones who are supreme. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ سَبَقَتْ كَلِمَتُنَا لِعِبَادِنَا الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And verily our word and our promise has already passed by to our pious messengers. إِنَّهُمْ لَهُمُ الْمَنْصُورُونَ. Verily they are the ones who are going to be helped. وَإِنَّ جُنْدَنَا لَهُمُ الْغَالِبُونَ. And my armies are the ones that are going to succeed. Our armies are the ones that are going to succeed. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse. So my friends, ultimately without doubt, if Allah is the owner of Qadr, if Allah is the one from whom victory comes from, ultimately without doubt, the end is for Islam. But a people cannot achieve this until they achieve and they hold on to the right way of achieving success. That can only happen if we come back to this deen. It can only happen if we come back to this deen. For that verse is truly very, very clear. Inna Allaha la yughayyiru ma biqawmin hatta yughayyiru ma bi anfusihim. Allah will not change a person until they change their rulers. Is that the case? No, Allah didn't say that. Allah says Allah will not change a people until they change themselves. So my friends, what is the real thing that I want to talk to you all about today? It is about two important points, or three important points. I'll think about the third one soon. The first one that I want to talk to you about is I want every single person to understand that our true success can only happen through Islam. That Islam has the answers and it is the only way that can guarantee us the right vision. Remember I spoke about this? That only when you have a sound ideology can you have a sound purpose for your existence and a sound purpose for your vision. And only then can you have a sound vision. And only when you have a sound vision can you actually have the right steps that actually lead towards it. But Allah, if your ideology is wrong, your purpose of your vision will be wrong, and so your vision will be wrong, and ultimately your direction will be corrupt. So my friends, stick to Islam and stick to the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Bite onto it with your molar tooth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أُدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّ. Enter into Islam, or you believe, enter into Islam in its entirety, in every single thing about the deen. My friends, every single thing about the deen, whatever it is, you must love it. Love it. Put it in your heart until you crave it. This is what is an absolute must. You must enter into Islam in its entirety. Sisters, even if you hate polygamy from happening to yourself, you cannot hate the institution of polygamy. It is part of Islam. If there's something about the deen that you do not like, it may be something, by Allah, that you can work on fixing. Because ultimately, true success can only come from you holding on to this deen. And every single thing about it will lead you to success. The companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, by Allah, there is not a single good thing. There is not a single bird that is flying in the air and that is beating its wings, except that the Prophet ﷺ, there was some good about it, the Prophet ﷺ would have told us about it. By Allah, this deen contains every single thing that is good for us. Whereas the religion of the past didn't have everything that was good for them. Ultimately, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the religions of the past, because of the lot of questions and the haram that they were doing and the extra questions they were asking upon themselves, Allah made a lot of things that are good for them haram upon them. Whereas our religion, if anything is ordained in a religion, automatically it is good. And if something is halal, automatically it's good for us. And if something is haram, automatically it is bad for us. So let us come back to the deen and let us come back comprehensively. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Hajj, وَلِيَنْصُرُنَّ اللَّهَ مَا يَنْصُرُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَلِلَّهِ عَاقِبَةُ الْأُمُورِ. Allah says, and indeed Allah will surely help those who help Him. Those who, if we establish them on this earth, they would establish the prayer and they would give the zakat and they would order people to do that which is good and they would forbid people from that which is bad. And for indeed Allah is the end of affairs. Here, Ash-Shanqiti rahimahullah, Imam Ash-Shanqiti, who was the great scholar of tafsir, who lived about 50 years ago, may Allah have mercy upon him. Sheikh Muhammad Al-Amin Ash-Shanqiti, he says in his book Adwal Bayan, in these verses is a proof that a people can only attain the help of Allah, and that a people can only attain success as long as they do what Allah says in the second verse. And that only when they're doing what Allah says in the second verse are they actually helping Allah. And when they're helping Allah, they're assured of the help back from Allah. What is it that Allah says in the second verse? Alladhina, those who, in makkannahum fil ard, if when we establish them and give them authority and power on this earth, aqamu salah, they establish the prayer, wa atawu zakat, and give the zakat, and they forbid against the wrong and they command that which is right. These are the ones, and it is only when we do this, when we go back to the deen, that we'll be helping Allah, and as a result Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help us. My brothers and sisters in Islam, the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is like the ark of Nuh alayhi salatu wasallam. That ark, you know, the fulk, that the ship of Nuh alayhi salatu wasallam, whoever gets on the ship is saved and anyone else is drowned. Be assured of that. Imam Malik rahimahullah used to say, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is like the fulk of Nuh alayhi salatu wasallam. You either get on it and thus be saved, or if you are not on it, then you will all be destroyed and drowned. Also, a man came to Imam Malik rahimahullah and said, "Ya Imam, where should I put the ihram on from?" So Imam Malik, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him, said, "Put your ihram on from where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his ihram on, which is Dhul Hulaifa, about 5 kilometers outside of Medina." So the man said, "What if I wanted to put my ihram on from Medina itself, which is a little bit earlier, and so therefore it's probably better because ultimately I'd be more pious, more righteous, I'm doing it earlier. Is that not better?" So Imam Malik rahimahullah says, "No." He says, "I fear fitna upon you." He said, "What?" "I fear fitna upon you." So at that point the man said, "What do you mean fitna? What fitna?" Well, then Imam Malik, may Allah have mercy upon him, he said, "Let those who disobey Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam," okay, "let those who go against the obedience of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فَلْيَحْذُرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ." Let those who go against the way of Muhammad ﷺ be aware lest a fitna or a terrible punishment take them over. We know what a terrible punishment means, but what does fitna mean? Imam Ahmed, may Allah have mercy upon him, in the tafsir of this verse, he said, "Al-fitna huwa al-kufr." The fitna, he al-kufr. The fitna that is being meant in this verse is disbelief. Meaning that if you go against the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then be aware two things could happen to you. Either a very terrible disaster and punishment will befall you very soon in your life in this world or the hereafter, or both. Or ultimately what's going to happen is fitna going to come to you, which is disbelief. This belief is going to come into your heart. And by Allah, how common is this belief now? We might joke about something about the deen. We might wake up and we have missed Fajr and we say, oh, you know, that's okay. We just rush off to work. We might go to sleep and we haven't prayed Isha. By Allah, this belief. We wake up a Muslim and we go to sleep a kafir. And we go to sleep and we wake up a kafir. I mean, what is this? This is exactly how disbelief has become so common. Why? Because of leaving the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. My friends, when I speak about the sunnah, people divide up things into sunnah. They say, well, you know what? Dhuhr is 4 rak'ahs, so I'll just pray 4 rak'ahs. And all the other things are sunnah anyway. Why should I have to pray it? You know what? For a person who says that he is from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, for a person who thinks he is from the people of Sunnah, how dare he leave the Sunnah? How dare he leave that which he considers to be Sunnah? It is not possible, my Shaykh used to tell me, when I used to sometimes miss my Sunnah, and I would just rush off to do something thinking that, okay, Talab al-Ilm is more important, gaining knowledge is more important. He would say, it is not possible for a person who wants to be from Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah, for him to leave the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not possible at all, is it? And by Allah, irrespective of whether it's sunnah or not, it is all from the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we should all struggle to do. The second point I want you to do in order to bring on the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to struggle with yourselves. To struggle once you have found Islam and you have found the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, bite onto it with your molar tooth and then struggle with your life and with your wealth for this cause. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ تِجَارَةٍ تُنْجِيكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Oh, you who believe, shall I not guide you towards a business transaction that will save you from a terrible torment? تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَبِرَسُولِهِ. Believe in Allah and then his messenger, وَتُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ. And then you struggle in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your wealth and with your life. ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. That is better for you if indeed you are believers. يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ مِنْ ذُنُوبِكُمْ وَيُدْخِلُكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. He will forgive all your sins and enter you into a gardens under which rivers flow. وَمَسَاكِنُ طَيِّبَةٍ فِي جَنَّاتِ عَدْنٍ. And verily give you places of dwelling in the eternal gardens of Jannah. وَذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. And that is the greatest achievement. Then he says, وَأُخْرَى تُحِبُّونَهَا. And something else that you love. نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيبٌ. And something else Allah is going to give you in this life. What is that? نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ. Help from Allah, وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيبٌ, and a early and easy victory. Subhanallah. And what is the victory here? The tafsir of the verse means that Allah will establish your deen for you in this earth. And what does nasr mean? What does help from Allah mean? It means Allah will help us with His armies from the unseen world around us. So my friends, this is the easy way to victory, that we struggle with our life for this deen. That we find the deen, we hold on to it with our molar teeth, and then we struggle for it with our life and our wealth. And finally, my friends, remember one important point. Just keep on dreaming. You know, these days we just dream in our dreams. We don't dream whilst awake. And what I'd like you all to do is dream when you're awake, and then put that into plan. However, when someone starts to do that, one of the problems I've noticed with people is that they focus on helping others rather than themselves first. They think that when we dream high, we must dream about how to help Islam and how to help Muslims, but then they forget themselves. And this is usually the problem with the da'is. Usually one of the greatest problems with the da'is. One of the scholars of the past, they used to say that my wife used to say, I hate books. Why? Why do you hate books? Because the books take my husband away from me. The books take my husband away from me. And this is a problem. Why? Because the man hasn't worked to rectify his own role as a husband. There was a story of a friend that I had who told me that he used to work for this large relief organization. Then he went to visit a colleague of his who was a new You know, he was newly back into the deen. He had married a very, very religious girl who was wearing a niqab and everything, came from a religious family. And so he went to his friend and says, why don't you come with me? I'm going to Bosnia for a few months in order to help the Muslims of Bosnia. This was after the war in Bosnia. So he said, you know what, that's fine, but I've, you know what, you know, I've got to ask the interior ministry for a visa. So that's good, no problem, go ahead and ask them. Then he went and he asked his wife said, no, I want to speak to your friend. So the interior ministry wanted to speak directly to the friend. So she spoke and she sat down, and so they said that they organized themselves in a room and the sister was in the other room. And so she spoke and then she asked specifics about how long, when is he going, what flight is he taking, how long will he be there for, and who will be looking after him, etc., etc., who's paying for the ticket, etc. And then when the brother said, she kept on asking all of these specifics, I was curious, seeing a woman who was religious, who is pious, who fears Allah on the last day, and that is apparent on her, why is she saying all of these things? Why is she asking so many things? And this is questions which you don't expect pious people, righteous people to ask. You'd expect them to say, yeah, go, my husband, please go. I want him to be more active in the deen. And when he asked, why, sister, are you asking all of this? Because I would not expect someone like you to ask these negative questions. At that point she said, my father was a da'i. My father was a preacher to Islam. And my mother, when she married me off, when I got married, my mom told me, oh, my daughter, never marry a da'i. And you know, shocking. I know you're laughing, but it's shocking, isn't it? It's shocking. Why? Because the du'at have destroyed their image with their own families. Our own families speak about their problems. Why? Rasulullah's family never cried that the Prophet was away 19 battles, 36 months traveling. They never cried. They were, Allah says to them, وَذْكُرْنَا مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. And remind, O wives of Rasulullah from the beautiful way of Rasulullah in your homes. Why is it that the wives of Rasulullah weren't crying that their husband was a da'i, etc. But our wives are crying that your husbands are du'at. Don't marry, don't let your husband become a da'i, because if that happens, you're not going to have any time. Why? It's because we have failed with our own selves. We haven't started with our own selves. We haven't started with our own families first. And this is my point of advice. That before you do anything, then start with your own self. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَدُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ. O you believe, upon you is your own self. It does not harm you if everyone is misguided as long as you are guided. So upon you is your own selves, my brothers. And upon you is your own family. Start with them first. And I want to end with words of wisdom that I found once written on a tomb of an Anglican bishop in Westminster Abbey when I was sightseeing in London. And in this tomb, obviously you shouldn't be visiting tombs, right? But this is the tomb of an Anglican bishop in Westminster Abbey who died in the year 1100 of the Christian era. Listen to it, it's really, really full of wisdom. Listen to it. He said, when I was young and free, my imagination had no limits. I dreamed of changing the world. As I grew older and wiser, I discovered the world would not change. So I shortened my sights somewhat and decided to only change my country. But that too seemed immovable. As I grew into my twilight years, in one last desperate attempt, I settled for changing only my own family, those closest to me. But alas, they would never have anything of it. And now as I lie on my deathbed, I suddenly realize, if I had only changed myself first, then by example I would have changed my family. From their inspiration and encouragement, I would then have been able to better my locality, my society, and then my country. And who knows, perhaps I may have even changed the world. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Allah, is my level of ikhlas now ready to take now double number of students or not? Dawud ibn Abi Hind, another great scholar of Islam. Another great scholar of Islam. They said when he died,
that they found out that his family never knew that Dawood ibn Abi Hind was actually fasting for 40 years.
This audio is brought to you by Muslim Central. Please consider donating to help cover our running costs and future projects by visiting www.muslimcentral.com/donate.